Hey folks, while I'm trying to figure out how to upload the last Final Destination video without getting a freaking migraine, we are moving on to a topic I've wanted to talk about for a long time. I know, I say that about almost all my topics, but this time it's true. We are in 2024 as of now, so 60 years ago, a remarkable movie came into theaters. A movie that still stands proudly as my number one favorite Disney movie. And I mean out of anything Disney related. 2D animated, 3D animated, live action and hybrids, which this one happens to be. I am talking of course about Mary Poppins from 1964. Now, before Home Alone, before Bambi, there was Mary Poppins for me. Even before most children channels and shows put on TV at the time, there was Mary Poppins. I am convinced to this day that this is the very first feature-length movie I have ever seen in my life. I am sure of this because it is so chiseled in my memory, and I think there's even footage of me dancing along the movie at the age of freaking one. Now, why am I so passionate about what seems to be a generic kids movie from the old times? What is so astounding about it, aside from the heavily biased nostalgic weight it carries? I am gonna tell you exactly that. And of course, I'm gonna draw. I'm talking purely about the movie from 1964, not the sequel or even the books from P.L. Travers. I would love to read the book someday, but I'm simply not a bookworm. I know, uncultured swine I am. So, the story of the flying magical nanny is unfolding slowly in the upper class part of London, 1910. Where a fancy but dysfunctional family, the Banks family, resides, having trouble with finding a proper nanny for the two children, Jane and Michael. After nanny number, who's counting, leaves the house in a fuss, George Banks arrives home from work. George Banks is the patriarch of this family, and wow, does he know it. They don't fail to make it clear from the start that this man does everything on a schedule, even his slippers, cherry and pipe. All about organizing and rules. George advertises in the Times for a new nanny, while Jane and Michael show him their own written ad. And even though George is very reluctant to listen to it, his wife, Winifred, suggests that they listen. Winnie is portrayed as quite a doormat who follows her husband like a shadow, even though she is part of the sister suffragette movement. That is not to say she has absolutely no authority in this household. She is the one telling him to hush and listen to the ad. It's the only moment she gets in the movie, but it's still something. After reading their ad, George sends them upstairs, rips the ad apart and throws it in the fireplace. Jeez, that's cold. That's a cool thing to do, even in the 1910s. However, as he's calling the Times, the ripped paper parts of the children's ad start to move up the chimney and float in the air as the wind changes direction the very next morning. There is this little gag going on throughout the movie where every hour of the day, the neighbors fire a cannon on their roof to usher the hour, I guess. Everybody goes to their assigned places and, well, prevent everything from falling. It's so weird, but it fits the whimsical nature of the movie. And wouldn't you know, a line of ambitious nannies are waiting outside the Banks residence. Wow, that's quick. Didn't George have the ad placed like the day before? Oh well. When I said the wind changed direction, I also meant it changed speed. Cause nannies are suddenly flying around the block. And when the path is cleared, Mary Poppins appears. Okay, rude. Apparently, she's the one making the winds going all crazy, making sure she has no competition. Anyhow, Mary Poppins arrives and kind of verbally aggressively makes her way into the position. She straight up says she doesn't believe in resumes, doesn't even introduce herself properly. All she does is reading the qualifications from the ad. Oh no, not George's one. The children's. The one he ripped apart. George's reaction upon realizing this is just gold. He is so utterly confused, down to the point of reenacting his steps. Mary just goes on and hires herself practically, going straight to the nursery. And as she is making her way upstairs, George is still inspecting the fireplace. Up in the nursery, Mary starts to show off her magic abilities. It begins with the bag Hermione Granger wishes she had, then they all start to tidy up the room. These effects are fantastic for the time being. Of course, you can tell the blue screens, the reversed shots and string work, but this is incredible. What this scene also seems to convey is that Mary Poppins' magic works a very specific way. She herself can do magical things, but it's also apparent that her entire environment gets influenced as well. The children perform magic to clean the room too. Reminds me a bit of Jim Carrey's The Mask. You know, the power of the mask doesn't just change Stanley Ipkiss. Everything he comes into contact with seems to be influenced as well and goes along with the flow. Mary Poppins' magic works the same way. Oh, and Ellen's reaction to them sliding off the stair railing is the purest, priceless thing ever. The trio is off to the park and bump into Bert, another very interesting figure. Bert was already introduced to us at the very start of the movie, being a street performer, and now he is an artist, drawing chalk on the tiles of the park. Every time you see this man, he has a different job. He is to be a bit of an enigma, a man of mystery. Is he the same as Mary, a magical person? What exactly is his relation to Mary? How did they meet? Who are all these women he apparently has dated before Mary? For real, my man over here has been around. So Bert shows them his drawings, and Mary takes this as an opportunity to transition us into the next couple of scenes, taking place inside one of the drawings. Yeah, that's right. They literally jump into the drawing. And take a look at this. Take a freaking look at these effects. This is freaking 1964, ladies and gentlemen. Also, that dress. I want that dress. I want it now. Where can I order? Inside this chalk world, they have all kinds of fun adventures, such as visiting a farm, having tea at a cafe run by penguins, riding a carousel and free roaming, joining the hunt, and a race. It is a lot. It's a lot. Like, it almost comes across as filler. There is nothing in here that contributes to the plot, really. And I suspect they did this entire chalk drawing world just to show off their effects. Well, it worked. This is all so impressive, imaginative, and full of wonder and fantasy. I don't even care if it furthers the plot. I could stay here for hours. But alas, all good things come to an end, as it starts to rain and it's washing the drawing away, leaving Mary, Bert and the kids back on the streets of London. A couple of days have passed and Mary's influence on the Banks household begins to show. Everybody is uncharacteristically cheery and joyful, that is, except George, who again is being a stick in the mud. Mary and the children were on their way to the marketplace, but have to change their plans abruptly when news about Mary's uncle makes way. They hush themselves over there, meet up with Bert, and find Uncle Albert on the ceiling, laughing uncontrollably. Yeah, in this universe, laughing makes you light as a feather and you will float. And of course, laughing is highly contagious. But so is sadness. When Mary and the children have to go back home, Uncle Albert sobs and lands back down on the floor. Unlike the chalk world scene, this one actually has some narrative contribution to the plot, being that all good things eventually come to an end, and it happens sooner than you think. So enjoy it while it lasts. This is gonna come back very hard at the end of the movie. The other moral of the story that is gonna make an appearance is when Mary sings the Feed the Bird song to Jane and Michael. As an example, she sings about the Bird Lady, a poor old woman that lives on the steps of St. Paul and tries to make a living out of selling bird food. This song was Walt's favorite Disney song, and it's easy to hear why. It's incredibly wistful, even a bit sad and tragic in its undertones. Feed the Birds practically tells us that when we have the opportunity to perform an act of kindness, we better do it. No matter how insignificant it may seem, such as spending tuppence on bird food, because the tiniest gesture on your part can mean the world to someone else. And you better do it while you can, because there might not be another time to do it. Remember this, because again, it's gonna come back later. At the bank, George introduces his children to the directors, and Mr. Dawes Sr., the founder of the bank, stumbles slowly from his office towards the bank's children, eager like all others to indoctrinate the breed into the world of finances, sings a little song about investment and takes the tuppence out of Michael's hand. Michael is not responding kindly to this and demands his money back. His yells are heard from all over the lobby, and believe it or not, a run starts to occur. You know, when so many people at the same time want to extract their deposits, the bank simply can't keep up with it and risks collapsing. During all the chaos, Jane and Michael manage to escape and end up in the shady parts of London. This better not be Whitechapel. Scared and in a panic, they run into a chimney sweeper who turns out to be Bert. They explain to him what happened and come to the conclusion that their father hates them. Which is so sad to hear from a little child saying that about their parents. Bert reassures them that this is not the case and teaches them that George does love them dearly, but has a different way of showing it. He goes to that miserable bank every day of his life to provide for his family. And as a result, he puts career and work above everything else, missing big chunks of his children's childhood. Bert even tells them that their father might even need some help from them, to stand by his side and to be supportive. What an incredible lesson to teach young children. I love how the movie plays with this trope of the hardworking father who has no time for his family. We see this all the time in movies, but the way this movie handles it is very relatable. George is never truly demonized for his workaholism. The movie simply shows that there needs to be a balance between being a provider and being a father. Bert takes Jane and Michael home. Winnie is once again off to a meeting with the sister suffragette movement and suggests that Bert stays with the children to clean their chimney out. Winnie, you don't know this man, this random man that's covered in suits. You're gonna leave him with your children just like that? So Bert starts to swipe the chimney, and of course, the moment Mary walks in, the kids fly through the chimney, ending on the roof. Bert and Mary follow, and instead of going back the way they came, Mary leads the group through the forest of chimneys and smoke, on the rooftops of London. We even get a smoking staircase to the Big Ben itself. I've been praising this movie for its visuals so far, but I'm gonna show you the most gorgeous couple of frames in the entire movie. These are paintings. We got a nice little taste of them in the opening credits of the movie, but with a little bit of movie magic, these shots come to life. Music is of course helping though. Throughout it all, it's elevated stores by the music. But the best part of the movie is not even here yet. We will get to it soon. For now, after that little tour over the roofs, Bert's colleagues suddenly pop up and bring in an abrupt tone shift. We go from dreamy to energetic within seconds as Bert cues in the song Step in Time, or otherwise known as the Chimney Sweeper song. And this is the part where the movie seems to have drunk a few of these bad boys. It goes bonkers. Sweepers dancing all over the place with some wonderful choreography, challenging basic physics here and there, and all the while they keep having smiles on their face. These poor actors must be dying on the inside, yet they keep going and going and going. Like, you're going at a drunk party and everybody's having the time of their life. The neighbors, Admiral Boom and his first mate, seem to take less kindly to the party and start to shoot fireworks at them to chase them away. As a response, they simply continue their endeavors back down at the Banks' house.
As soon as Mr. Banks returns, the sweepers disappear as quickly as they came, taking their party somewhere else, I guess. Only Bert stays behind to clean up a bit. An outraged Mr. Banks barks at Mary for all this chaos in his house, and she just tells him to freaking deal with it. George is left alone with Bert, and we now get the scene that nicely exposes to us the core of the movie Mary Poppins. All the little hints of Uncle Albert being said that the children leave, Bert telling the children about cages and people needing help, to the Pete Bert sequence. It all comes together here in this conversation Bert and George have, man to man. And right after this, the most beautiful scene in not just this movie, but in almost all cinema history takes place. George Banks takes the walk. This walk, where a character has either a complete in-depth reflection on things or a change of perspective. And all they do is walk, ponder, think, wonder. George walks through the streets of London towards the bank, towards his inevitable resignation, towards losing everything he had worked for. He doesn't talk, we don't get his inner thoughts or anything, it's just him walking under the company of the dreamy but wistful instrumentals of Feed the Birds. He even takes a moment to see if the bird lady is at the stairs and notices she is not there anymore. I don't know if this implies anything, but George's facial expression suggests that he fears for the worst. Once he has arrived at the bank, escorted to the meeting room like an inmate at prison, he gets fired by Dawes Sr. for what his children have caused at the bank. And the man completely breaks apart. He even tells the joke Michael learned from Uncle Albert and Bert to Dawes Sr. and after his mental breakdown, he skips out of the room, now that he has nothing to lose anymore. Dawes sitting there letting the joke sink in and finally getting it makes me laugh so hard, it's so funny. The next morning, everybody at the bank's house is worried sick. George hasn't returned home that night, but he does show up, barely recognizable, and tells him what happened. I lost our main source of income, now we can't pay our bills anymore, neither keep our beloved staff or house. Yay! I know, I'm sorry. The tale does end very happy though, as George fixes Michael's kite and goes to the park together with his children and his wife. The very first time we see the whole family happy together. They even bump into the bank's directors and learn that Dawes Sr. has died of laughter. As macabre as that sounds, the man died a happy man and George gets to take over his position. Mary, meanwhile, has taken all her stuff and takes flight, along with the change in the wind. Bert greets her a temporary goodbye, implying they will meet again soon, and the credits roll. Guys, it's a kids' movie. But it's the very best kind of kids' movie. It never talks down on its audience, it has mature in-depth moments, and it teaches important life lessons. But above everything, it's wondrous. Incredibly wondrous. I don't think movies nowadays can wow us anymore to that same level. We have been exposed to so much content, stories, media and such, especially in this era of endless streaming. But back then, when cinema was still a relatively new medium, the power of movies such as this is unbelievable. People standing up when the head in Jaws pops up. People screaming and fleeing the theater when Rexy from Jurassic Park comes into frame for the first time. Singing and waving along with Friend Like Me in Aladdin. I wasn't there. I am from the early 90s, but the stories I have heard? The last genuinely great cinema experience for me was with the first Deadpool movie. Everybody heckled like hacks during the just opening credits. It was my first Valentine's Day with my husband, and it was wonderful. Mary Poppins is one of those movies I would have loved to see the year it came out. To get immersed into it together with everybody else. It is my number one Disney movie. It is somewhere in my top somewhat movies of all time. And it is the movie that perfectly represents my inner child.